Travis, Leonora Carrington, the time has come that I must tell the events which began in 40 Pest Street. The houses, which were reddish-black, looked as if they had issued mysteriously from the fire of London. The house in front of my window, covered with an occasional wisp of creeper, was as black and empty-looking as any plague-ridden residence subsequently licked by flames and smoke. This is not the way that I had imagined New York. It was so hot that I got palpitations when I ventured out into the streets, so I sat and considered the house opposite and occasionally bathed my sweating face. The light was never very strong in Pest Street.
There was always a reminiscence of smoke,
which made visibility troubled and hazy. Still, it was possible to study the house opposite carefully,
even precise. Besides, my eyes have always been excellent.
I spent several days watching for some sort of movement opposite, but there was none, and I finally took to undressing quite freely before my open window, and doing my breathing exercises optimistically in the thick Pest Street air.
This must have made my lungs as black as houses. One afternoon, I washed my hair and sat out on the diminutive stone crescent which served as a balcony to dry it. I hung my head between my knees and watched a blue bottle suck the dry corpse of a spider between my feet. I looked up through my long hair and saw something black in the sky, ominously quiet for an airplane. Parting my hair, I was in time to see a large raven
alight on the balcony of the house opposite. It sat on the balustrade and seemed to peer into the empty window. Then it poked its head under its wing, apparently searching for life.
A few moments later, I was not unduly surprised to see the double windows open and admit a woman onto the balcony.
She carried a large disc
full of bones, which she emptied onto the floor. With a short appreciative squeak, the raven hopped down and poked about amongst its unpleasant repast. The woman, who had very long black hair, used her hair to wipe out the dish. Then she looked straight at me and smiled in a friendly fashion. I smiled back and waved a towel.
This served to encourage her, for she tossed her head coquettishly and gave me a very elegant salute after the fashion of a queen. Do you happen to have any bad meat over there that you don't need?
She called.
Any what?
I called back, wondering if my ears had deceived me.
Any stinking meat? Decomposed flesh meat? Not at the moment, I replied,
wondering if she was trying to be funny.
Won't you have any towards the end of the week? If so, I would be very grateful if you would bring it over.
Then she stepped back into the empty window and disappeared. The raven flew away. My curiosity about the house and its occupant prompted me to buy a large lump of meat the following day. I set it on the balcony on a bit of newspaper and awaited developments. In a comparatively short time, the smell was so strong that I was obliged to purge through my daily activities with a strong paper clip on the end of my nose. Occasionally, I descended into the street to breathe. Towards Thursday evening, noticed that the meat was turning color, so waving aside a flight of rancorous blue bottles, I scooped it into my sponge bag and set out for the house opposite. I noticed, descending the stairs, that the landlady seemed to avoid me. It took me some time to find the front door of the house opposite. It turned out to be hidden under a cascade of something, giving the impression that nobody had been either in or out of this house for years. The bell was of the old-fashioned kind that you pull, and when I pulled it rather harder than I intended, it came right off in my hand. I gave the door an angry push and it caved inwards, emitting a ghastly smell of putrid meat. The hall, which was almost dark, seemed to be of carved woodwork.
The woman herself came rustling down the stairs, carrying a torch. How do you do?
How do you do?
She murmured ceremoniously. And I was surprised to notice that she wore an ancient, beautiful dress of green silk. But as she approached me, I saw that her skin was dead white and glittered as if speckled with thousands of minute stars.
Isn't that kind of you?
She went on, taking my arm with her sparkling hand.
Won't my poor little rabbits be pleased?
We mounted the stairs, and my companion walked so carefully that I thought she was frightened. The top flight of stairs opened into a boudoir, decorated with dark room furniture and red plush. The room was littered with gnawed bones and animal skulls. It's so seldom that we get a visit, the woman smiled.
So they all scatter off
into their little corners.
She uttered a low, sweet whistle and transfixed. I saw about 100 snow-white rabbits emerge cautiously from every nook,
their large pink eyes fixed unblinkingly upon the woman.
Come, pretty ones. Come, pretty ones.
She cooed, diving her hand into my sponge bag and pulling out a handful of rotting meat. With a sensation of deep disgust, I backed into a corner and saw her throw the carrion amongst the rabbits, who fought like wolves for the meat.
One becomes very fond of them,
the woman went on.
They each have their little ways. You'd be surprised how very individual rabbits are.
The rabbits in question were tearing at the meat with their sharp buck teeth.
We eat them, of course, occasionally.
My husband makes a very tasty stew every Saturday night.
Then a movement in the corner caught my attention, and I realized that there was a third person in the room. As the woman's torchlight touched his face, I saw he had identical glittering skin, like tinsel on a Christmas tree. He was dressed in a red gown and sat very rigidly with his profile turned towards us. He seemed to be unconscious of our presence or of that of a large white buck rabbit which sat masticated on a chunk of meat on his knee. The woman followed my gaze and chuckled. That is my husband. The boys used to call him Lazarus. At the sound of this familiar name, he turned his face towards us and I saw that he wore a bandage over his eyes.
A fool?
He inquired in a rather thin voice.
I won't have any visitors here. You know quite well that I've strictly forbidden it.
Now, Laz, don't start carrying on. Her voice was plaintive.
You can't grudge me a little bit of company. It's 20-odd years since I've seen a new face. Besides, she's brought meat for the rabbits.
She turned and beckoned me to her side.
You want to stay with us, do you not, my dear?
I was suddenly clutched by fear, and I wanted to get out and away from these terrible silver people and the white carnivorous rabbits.
I think I must be going.
It's supper time. The man on the chair gave a shrill peal of laughter, terrifying the rabbit on his knee,
which banged to the floor and disappeared.
The woman thrust her face so near to mine that her sickly breath seemed to anesthetize me.
Do you not want to stay and become like us? In 7 years, your skin will be like stars. In 7 little years, you'll have the holy disease of the Bible, leprosy.
I stumbled and ran, choking with horror.
Some unholy curiosity made me look over my shoulder as I reached the front door.
And I saw her waving her hand over the banister. And as she waved it, her fingers fell off and dropped to the ground like shooting stars.